all very much, it's all linked. It's got to link somehow. The walrus. I am here, you are me, and we are together. That's what you mean. But who is the walrus? You say, baby, you're a rich man. I think has to link to the walrus. Because I think the walrus is a rich person. But I can't think it's one of the Beatles themselves, because I think that would be too obvious. Why, who would Lennon make it be? Brian Epstein. Brian Epstein. Ooh, it could be. I think if Epstein's the walrus, Epstein's very rich, so he could be the rich man. And because he's rich, he could live on Blue Jay Way. Maybe he has a property on Blue Jay Way, I don't know. And he's allegedly gay, Mr. Epstein, even though he's sadly no longer with us. But he was allegedly gay. Which could mean you've got to hide your love away. It's about him. But then, come to think of it, does his mother know? Your mother should know. The walrus has to be Brian Epstein, because he's the rich man who lives on Blue Jay Way, and his mother should know that he's got to hide his love away. I've cracked it. I know who the walrus is. Oh, calm yourself. Deep breaths. I know who the walrus is. I know who the walrus is. I've got to tell him. I've got to tell him. Andrew, it's me, it's Walter, hello. I know who the walrus is. No, listen. Brian Epstein, bear with me here. It's got to be Epstein. Because, baby, you're a rich man. It's got to be Brian Epstein, because he's rich. And he's got to live on Blue Jay Way. And his mother must know that he's gay. But if not, then it's because he's got to hide his love away. I've got to go down. I've got it, man. New album. Yeah, it comes out. I know it comes out today, but I've been locked away in my attic trying to figure out who the walrus is. So now I don't know. I don't know about the new album. No. What do you mean the walrus was Paul? It's Brian Epstein. I just told you. There's a new song that says the walrus is Paul. Right, okay. Yeah, I'll give it a listen, I suppose. Yeah. No. It's my fault. I should have listened to it this morning. Thank you. What's it called? Okay. I'll give it a listen, Andrew. Thank you. The walrus was Paul. Start it all again. Glass Onion, the new song. Better go and listen to Glass Onion then. What even is a Glass Onion?
Throughout the 60s, whenever the Beatles released a new record, certain fans would take it upon themselves to try and find out what the true meaning of the songs were. So they would start analysing the lyrics to try and find hidden messages. And they would even go as far as to play the records backwards to try and find out what these hidden messages were that the Beatles had put in their records. This really annoyed John Lennon because he couldn't understand why people were analysing Beatles lyrics so much, why they felt there was a hidden meaning in there, because none of the Beatles were intending for there to be hidden meanings in there. In 1967, John even found out that his old school in Liverpool were analysing Beatles lyrics in literature classes. This again really annoyed him, so he decided he'd write the song I Am the Walrus to try and confuse them, and he succeeded really. They just, no one could understand what it meant, and yeah, John just really liked winding them up, basically, these people who like to find hidden meanings in his songs. However, John wasn't done with those who read too much into Beatles lyrics. He decided it was time to write another song for them to wind them up even further, to confuse them even more. This time he decided that he would refer back to numerous other Beatles songs. The songs in question were Strawberry Fields Forever, I Am the Walrus, The Fool on the Hill, Lady Madonna, and Fixing a Hole. So as well as referring back to those numerous other Beatles songs, John also introduced some new concepts in this song. The first one was the Cast Iron Shore. This was a South Liverpool coastal area that really no one outside of Liverpool is going to know. He also introduced the bent back tulips, the dovetail joint, and the glass onion itself, which was all just nonsensical stuff really. It wasn't ever intended to mean anything, but John knew that people would read into this and try and find meaning, so he was just trying to annoy these people, lead them on a wild goose chase really. So out of all the lyrics throughout the song, the one that has always garnered the most attention, that has drawn the most analysis with these people who like to analyze Beatles lyrics, is the line, "The walrus was Paul." This is obviously referring back to "I am the walrus." But what does it mean? How is the walrus Paul? What does that even mean? Well, a lot of people feel, who are into all this stuff, that this is something to do with the Paul is Dead conspiracy. I'll be honest, I don't really fully understand how it works myself, but they seem to think the walrus is a symbol of death or something in some culture, and this is them saying that the walrus is Paul because the walrus symbolises death. Makes sense of that. But anyway, John dismissed all this. He just said it was a throwaway line. It didn't mean anything. It was simply poetry. He could have said anything. The walrus was George if he wanted, or he could have said the fox terrier was Paul, that sort of thing. It didn't mean anything. But in later years, John did go on to say that this was his way of trying to keep the Beatles illusion going with Paul, to sort of give Paul a false sense of security because John really wanted out the band. I don't quite understand the logic of that myself, but you know, I don't want to be one of these people that reads into Beatles lyrics too much. But to me, the way I've always interpreted this line was, if you listen to the whole verse, "I told you about the walrus and me, man, you know that we're as close as can be, man. Well, here's another clue for you all, the walrus was Paul." You've just got to listen to it properly. All he's saying to me there is that him and Paul are as close as can be. That's all he's saying, that him and Paul are still best friends. I genuinely don't think there's any hidden meaning in that, but you know, certain people will have you believe that there is a lot of meaning applied to that lyric. The name Glass Onion was a suggestion for a band name, actually. This was for the Apple Sign band known as the Ivories at that point. John was suggesting this for their name instead of the Ivories, but they wouldn't go with that. In the end, they would settle with Badfinger, and Badfinger would go on to have quite a bit of success, really. Out of all of the Apple Signed artists beside the Beatles, Badfinger was probably the most successful one. Their song, "Come and Get It," which Paul wrote for them in 1969, was quite a big hit single. Anyway, for Glass Onion, John liked the phrase anyway, so he kept it. He held back and kept it for this song because he liked its sort of dual meaning, how it was both transparent and multiple layers. Ogres have layers.
Onions have layers. Ogres have layers. Onions have layers.
You know, you know. Glass Onion would be one of 27 songs that the Beatles would demo at George's house in Esher in May 1968. However, at that point, the song wasn't complete. The lyrics were far from being finished. John only really had the first verse, which was the Strawberry Fields part. Otherwise, there wasn't much else there. The demo is mostly just John singing the first verse on repeat. Towards the end of the demo, which isn't really a long demo, it breaks down and it just becomes a load of gobbledygook. It's just John being nonsensical really, which kind of fits with the song and its whole theme. But yeah, it's a nice little acoustic demo. If you've never heard it, there's actually two places you can hear this Esher demo. You've got it on Anthology 3 or the 50th anniversary edition of the White Album. Whichever one of them takes your fancy, it's the same thing on both of them. The Beatles would begin recording Glass Onion on September 11th, 1968 at Abbey Road. The first day of sessions consisted predominantly of recording the basic track. They would record 34 takes that day, and they would set on take 33 being the best of the lot. The following day, John Lennon recorded his lead vocals for the song, and Ringo would record some tambourine for it. The day after that, another drum track and a piano part was added to the song, and then 3 days after that, Paul would add a brief recorder part to the song. On September 20th, the Beatles decided to add a load of sound effects to the song. This included a telephone ringing, some smashing glass, an organ note, and a BBC football commentator declaring, "It's a goal." Once these sound effects had been added to the track, a rough mono mix was created of the song. This mono mix with these sound effects can be heard on Anthology 3. However, on October 10th, for some reason, the Beatles decided that the sound effects were no longer needed. So they returned to work on the song, where they completely scrapped all the sound effects that had been recorded on September 20th. Instead, they decided that they would add something that the song really did need. When you hear the rough mono mix, it doesn't sound right, it doesn't sound finished. So they got George Martin to write a string section to orchestrate the track, and this orchestration was added to the song, which gave it kind of that I Am The Walrus style. The White Album was released on the 22nd of November 1968, and Glass Onion was the third track on the album. However, despite being the third track on it, it was the first track that actually featured all four Beatles on it, because as mentioned in previous episodes of this series, Ringo was absent on both Back in the USSR and Dear Prudence. But he was here, he was drumming on this one, so all four Beatles are on it. Ringo has finally appeared on the album. Go Ringo! Woohoo! Peace and love, Ringo. Just no fan mail, because it'll be tossed.
If that has a date on the envelope, it's going to be tossed. I'm warning you with peace and love, but I have too much to do. So no more fan mail. Thank you, thank you.
So for me personally, Glass Onion, of all the tracks on the White Album, is probably the song that is closest to what the Beatles have been doing in the immediate past. It was what they'd been doing in 67 with the stuff on Sgt. Pepper and Magical Mystery Tour. This was the closest on the entire White Album, I would say, to that kind of style of music. I imagine, you know, George Martin has said in the past that he thought that after they'd done Pepper, they would be doing more albums like that, of that style. Well, this song is probably the sort of thing he was expecting. But they didn't do that. This was a one-off on this album, really. And it's nice because it is that taste of psychedelic rock. It's about the only psychedelic rock on the White Album. And I think it's nice. It's nice that John is still doing those songs to annoy people. Those people who analyse Beatles lyrics too much. Because who would do that? So yeah, this song, it's nothing too serious. It's not like Dear Prudence, where it's trying to get someone to come out of their room, out of seclusion. This song is just John messing about to wind people up, because they wind him up. Yeah, I'll be honest, Glass Onion, it's never been one of my favourite songs. I wouldn't say it's one of the best songs on the White Album, but I enjoy it for what it is. I mean, it is a short song. It's only, what, 2.5 minutes, if that. But yeah, it's certainly nice to have a bit of psychedelic rock thrown in there. So yeah, Glass Onion, it's nice. It's like the sequel to I Am The Walrus. So that concludes episode 3 of the White Album in depth. Once again, thank you very much for watching. I hope you have enjoyed this episode. This is a series, like I've said previously, so if you're enjoying this, there is a playlist on my channel with all the previous episodes so far. That's Back in the USSR and Dear Prudence. All future episodes will also go in that playlist, so if you want to see more, go to that playlist. Anyway, like, comment, subscribe, all of that jazz. And yeah, I will see you next time, where I will be telling you all about the story of Desmond and Molly Jones. Until then though, take care. Pew.